my interest in my work is on the relationship between epistemology and ethics. Epistemology is the idea of how we are knowing beings. What is it to know something? Ethics usually pick up in terms of what I should and shouldn't do, but philosophers also think of this in terms of how we should be. And my work really is in the relationship of epistemological questions and ethical questions and how they come together. My approach to this is what's called virtue theory. It comes from Aristotle. And the idea is that what we have are virtues defined as mental dispositions. The disposition is sort of an ability to act in certain ways or a tendency to act in certain ways under certain conditions. It depends upon your character, and what Aristotle said is that you should develop your character in such a way so that you then are disposed to act ethically in appropriate ways. And virtue theory analyzes this in detail. My interest is in sort of combining that type of an approach with an evolutionary approach, and I think that as intelligent beings, there are a number of components, and much of my work has sort of been trying to find out what the elements would be that would be precursors to becoming knowing beings, because we didn't become knowing beings all at once. It just didn't happen at once. It had to happen through components. And so we can start to investigate these things now, in part through digital evolution, which is what my group does in part, and ask, how did we get the components to the point where we could say, now we are knowing beings or programming. And as I said, I think there's a connection between the epistemology and the ethics, because it has something to do with what we should do in order to become knowers, which is to say, know some things about the world. And I think that curiosity is one of the core dispositions that makes that possible. And that's what this is about. The theory behind that is in book, which comes out in 3 weeks. and the title of the book is what I'm really going to be talking about, because it's a book from Darwin. And really what I'm going to be doing here is a data-free talk, just as a warning. We do have a project underway that will look at the evolution of curiosity using digital organisms that evolve, and also my collaborator, Kay Holecamp, in hyenas, we'll be doing some things, and I hope that in year or two, I'll be able to actually report some results of that. But that's not what this talk is about. This is about sort of framing that, posing the question in terms of the way that Darwin posed it. So that's really what I'm after here. And mostly what I'm going to do is focus on a really distinctive and I think deep quote from Darwin. And really we're just going to go through and analyze the parts of it to kind of see how this all fits together. And I hope you'll see why this is an interesting approach and worth investigating. Here's the quote. I believe there exists, and I feel within me, an instinct for truth or knowledge or discovery of something of the same nature as the instinct of virtue. And that our having such an instinct is reason enough for scientific researches, even without any practical results ever ensuing from them. So this is Darwin reflecting upon his own feeling, his own attitude as a scientist. This is from a personal letter to his friend and colleague, John Henslow. And he's just reflecting upon something that he felt rather deeply within himself about what made him a scientist. He says, you know, some of these things may have practical value, but really we just do it for its own sake. And I think there's a lot in this quote. It's actually very deep insight that he had, not just about himself, but about what it is to be a scientist. And that's really what I'm interested in, right? I think of what we do as scientists as extending systematically what it is that we, as basic biological knowers, have. So science, I think of as systematic curiosity. And this is sort of the biological basis that makes that possible. So this is what I want to have us look at. And I'm just going to look at the parts of this in turn so you get a sense of all the things that are there. What is it that we're after as scientists? It's the aim of science. Well, he says, this is what I feel we're after. We're after truth or knowledge or discovery. Okay, so I want to look briefly at each of those terms because they're all loaded terms philosophically, and we want to not just accept them talking about finding out true things, sometimes that's a scary word. People think, oh, we don't find truth at all. And I think that's because mostly we think about truth or are asked to think about truth as though it's truth with a capital T, right? As though it's truth means something absolute. For some reason you might think that, because classical logic, true functional logic, is really either or. It's a two-valued binary notion. It's either true or false. And it seems as though, well, it's not absolutely true, but it's false. And that's probably what lends in part to this notion. There's also a religious basis that sort of thinks of truth as being something that somehow is sacred and so it has to be true with a capital T. But of course, in science, that's not the notion of truth that we're after. We're after a much more mundane notion of truth, where you can have degrees. This is more true than that. This is more likely than that. It comes with degrees. And I articulate this as sort of an analog notion of truth. And I think that that allows us to say that we're approaching the more and more true as we get along, or we're getting away from it. But it's not just either or. It's not just a binary notion. And when you think of truth in that kind of way, then it actually gives you a gradient that you can start to use as something that evolve, right? We can get better or worse, hopefully better as we evolve, to be able to find out true things about the world. Really, we're not going to survive very well if we can't do that, at least to some degree. Not absolute truth, but true enough. True enough vis-a-vis our competitors, true enough vis-a-vis the contingencies of the world, okay? But that gives us a way to think about what it is that we're after as scientists. More and more truer pictures of the world. That's what our models do. We're after knowledge, okay? And this is another philosophical concept that a lot of ink has been spilled over. And most of it has dealt with the concept of knowing that. And mostly in science, we talk about hypotheses as though they're linguistic entities. And that makes it seem as though we're talking about propositional knowledge, right? It's knowledge that such and such. And that's a really important type of knowledge, but it can't be the most basic type of knowledge, because propositional knowledge, linguistic knowledge, didn't come till later. So if you're going to have any account at all of how we could evolve to be knowing beings, you're going to have some kind of knowledge that's prior to propositional knowledge and so on. So my account says that we're going to start with something that philosophy is knowing how, know-how. Right? It's a kind of knowledge that really even animals can have, right? Know how to do this, the horse knows the way. If you don't have that type of knowledge, I think you're not going to have any chance of getting a start on becoming knowing beings. And I think to make the transition from the kind of knowledge that Darwin was thinking about initially biologically to the type of knowledge that he's thinking about that we want as scientists, you're going to have to make this transition from knowing how to then stating things in the language in terms of knowing that. My contention is that even in science, it's knowing how, which is the more basic notion. The other is built upon that. The third part is discovery. And this is, of course, what every scientist hopes to do, right? You want to make a discovery. You want to find out something that someone has never known before. That's the holy grail for this. The term itself says something about what that means. It's an uncovering of something. But specifically in science, a particular type of uncovering. And again, philosophically, this has to do with the idea of confirming things which are explanatory, right? You might say that you've discovered something, you've seen it for the first time and no one else has seen it. But really, scientifically, you haven't understood it unless you can say the reason why. Like, that's the thing that says I've made a discovery. You might have two people who've seen something, but it's the one who can explain it, that's the one that you give the credit to as a scientist. Okay, so that's what a real scientific discovery is. Okay. So if we're after this as scientists, you know that there's going to be a little more to it, okay? Some complexities to that. But I think we can begin to say some things about that. Here's the thing that's kind of curious. Darwin says he thinks that this is based upon an instinct. That this seeking for knowledge is a kind of instinct. And I think he's referring to curiosity, the that that's what it is. You know, we're trying to find things out about the world, to suss out the causal features of the world. And, you know, the world is full of curious creatures. And you can just find them everywhere. I've got a whole collection of lovely little creatures, all sort of figuring things out, especially young ones, but all the way through you can find these. Now, Darwin had a very nice example when he was out, we all know the finches and so on, but he was out in South America setting up his expeditions, he was doing all sorts of collections. The sailors were setting up camp. He's noticing a little fox that has sort of noticed the sailors setting up camp. He seems to be curious about it. And he comes up behind him and clubs him over the head. Another fox from my collection. The curiosity here did him in. But usually, it's positive, right? Curiosity lets you find out something new that would be potentially a resource, something of interest. Okay? That's the thesis that he has. Curiosity is something as an instinct that's useful for us. The thing that I think is especially interesting from my point of view is that he says this is of the same nature as the instinct of virtue. And in The Descent of Man, Darwin has a whole account of how we can evolve what he calls the moral sense. And he thinks of the moral sense as being built upon a series of instincts, social instincts, that let us recognize shoulds and shouldn'ts relative to other individuals and so on. And that, for me, is sort of this connection between the epistemology and the ethics, that we should think of these traits that give us the ability to find out about the world as having a moral component, as having a virtue-based component. This is what's especially fascinating to me about this. And he gives his account of how it is that you could have the regular process of evolution by natural selection in instinct for virtue. Now he says, right, having this kind of instinct is reason enough for scientific research, right? Satisfying our curiosity from our point of view is really enough. And I think that that's what drives basic research, right? We just want to find it. But he also points out, this is a caricature of Darwinism, I think he saw himself in this kind of way. But he also points out this point about without any practical result ever resulting from that. And in some sense, this has to do with you don't have to have applied science, which is correct. But I think that in some sense, he's wrong here, because what's behind the results of all of this is, in fact, something that gives you a selective advantage. Curiosity gives you a benefit. And that, I think, is what really drives this whole epistemological approach. And that's what I think is pretty interesting. And I think we can talk about this theoretically, and then we can begin to look at it empirically. And that's what I hope we'll find interesting as well. I won't be able to report some things until I've